I'm Jim Kearns, and welcome to EME 3214 Mechatronics here at Lawrence Tech. Today's topic is MATLAB and Simulink, why it's important, and we'll just run a really quick example of using Simulink to show you how it works. I should point out these slides are courtesy of Dr. Minders at Lawrence Tech. He has his own webpage or his own YouTube channel, and he's one of the instructors here and is the course coordinator for our Mechatronics program. So why would you use MATLAB and Simulink instead of something like Excel? Well, Excel is good for plotting general data, though personally I prefer MATLAB for that myself. It's good for static calculations, for interest calculations, a lot of things. It has its usefuls. It basically stinkerinos for dynamic systems, because when you get into dynamic systems, you have to solve differential equations, and it's just not a good tool for that. So for this class, Excel is not the tool we want to use. Most of you need practice with MATLAB, so even if it doesn't strictly require MATLAB to solve the problem, use it. What MATLAB does provide that Excel doesn't is that ability to solve those differential equations, and you don't have to write your own solvers. You can try to do that sort of thing in Excel, and I've seen it done. I've seen very elaborate dynamic models done in Excel, and in the end, the person that did the model, their basic comment was, why did I do this? I should have used MATLAB, okay? Learn from somebody else's mistakes. So it's got a rich library of math functions and capability. It has a scripting language, which once you get used to it, it's easy to use. It is kind of an old school thing. You know, it developed in the 60s and or 70s, I believe. I'd have to look. But so it's kind of an old style DOS-ish, if most of you aren't old enough to remember that kind of interface. But it's been around. It's the 500-pound gorilla in simulation and modeling. Simulink is a subset of MATLAB. You can graphically build models of physical devices, electrical, mechanical, hydraulic, and you can put in your own controller once you have the physical system modeled, and you can run simulations, and it does solve all the differential equations for you. You can graph the results, you can export the results, you can get a lot done. The simulation allows you to optimize and design things and test your controllers. Sometimes you have to test things and make sure they work before you actually get hardware. Imagine, if you would, the Saturn V that took astronauts to the moon. You know, the first time they launched that rocket, you know, it's just massive, thousands of tons. It had to go straight. It could have been a real disaster if the control systems were totally wrong, if you didn't pick the right gains. There's no opportunity for trial and error. So you had to do simulations and do the math ahead of time. They didn't use MATLAB in that case, but they would have been happy if they could have. It's widely used in industry. Again, like I said, the 500-pound gorilla. I've had students come back from job interviews where they've been asked about their MATLAB and Simulink experience. So. Another thing that is relatively new within the last few years and getting more and more popular is directly generating code out of a MATLAB Simulink model and importing it into a target processor for embedded systems. It could be a small chip, you know, like an ARM or something like that, but even powertrain controllers for automobiles, as complex as they are, there's a lot of direct code coming straight out of models. It saves time, it saves energy, you reduce the chance for mistakes due to somebody converting a model into C code or something. So that's kind of the way of the future. So learn it, love it, it's a wonderful tool. So we'll do a real quick example. Let's suppose you're an engineer designing a control system for a GPS satellite in orbit. You got to keep the satellite pointed in the right direction all the time. So it has a desired angular position. It's got a couple of chemical thrusters with electric control valves. The more voltage you send to those control valves, the more chemical thruster material. We'll assume that it's hydrogen peroxide, and we have a silver catalyst, so it's self-igniting. So the amount of hydrogen peroxide you send to the thruster, the more thrust you get. So thruster, you give it a voltage, it gives you thrust. That rotates the satellite. And there's an integrating gyro inside the sensor or inside the satellite that converts the angular position into some voltage that you can measure and use in your control system. How do we model this? Well, we figure out what are the things we need to do, write down our equations, get everything organized. So the sum of torques, we have two thrusters. They're some distance away from the center of gravity or center of mass of the thruster. Thrust is generates a torque. There's some damping, and it is J, the rotational inertia, times theta double dot, or angular acceleration. So that's essentially just Newton's law. Sum of the forces equals mass times acceleration. The damping or friction torque, we're going to call some constant B times theta dot. The thruster torque is, so there's two thrusters, it's two times the force of the thruster times the radius. So that gives us our torque or our moment, and our radius is this distance here. And we can plug all that into our equation of motion. The sum of the forces equals mass times acceleration. Rearranging that, we get our J theta double dot plus B theta dot is 2R times the force of the thruster. Solving for theta double dot, we get this equation down here, which, it's a dynamic system. It has derivatives. So we have theta, we have theta double dot, we have theta dot. So because there's derivatives, it's not a static solution, and we need to solve this differential equation. And that's what MATLAB excels at. We need to come up with some other things. Our actuator converts the voltage to force, as I mentioned. So the force of the thruster is some constant times that voltage input to the thruster control valve. The sensor gives us a voltage as a function of theta, and again, some multiplier or gain in that that converts from angles, radians, to volts. And from our target, we convert from theta desired, multiply by that same constant, and we get a desired voltage going into our control system. And these are static. There's no derivatives. It's just multiplying and dividing. It's just algebra. Controller, well, we'll choose a proportional controller for simplicity. It's just a constant. And we'll make a block diagram. And again, the controller is static. It's not. There's no derivatives. So let's jump into Simulink. So I can open up MATLAB. I can do a couple things here in Simulink. If I double click on this script file that I've created already, it has the constants I need. First, it just clears all the variables out, closes all figures to give us a clean start. We set up a number of constants. Our rotational inertia is 4 Newton meters. Our damping is 1 Newtons per radian per second. The radius, the distance from the center of mass to our thruster, is 0.5 meters. I should have typed that in here. You know, one of the keys to programming is comments. That may seem odd, but in my experience, comments are probably the most important part of a program because they tell you what's intended. They include things like units, so you don't get confused about units, and they give you English explanations of where you're going, why you're there, where did it come from, the thruster gain, gyro gain. Again, this is all important information. The information in the comments is important, and if the information in the comment seems to not match the information in the actual code, something is wrong. It's a key to tell you something needs to be fixed. And for our controller, we set as strictly a proportional controller, so we're going to set our gain for that controller, KP, to be 0.5. Click on this triangle up here, run. It also saves any changes we made in the process, And now in MATLAB workspace, we have values for B, J, KF, KP, etc. I can open the model file. Oh, that's this one. Double click on it. And there's my basic model. This implements our dynamic equations that we came up with. You can click anywhere on the white space and just type, and it will let you annotate and comment on your model. I recommend doing that. It's sometimes hard to follow an equation from all the blocks tied together, but if you type the equation out, that's, again, maybe easier to read. It gives you something to compare to. Did the equation I typed out match the equation I implemented in a block diagram? If it doesn't, you know, it's a hint where something might have went wrong. But let's walk through this. We have a desired theta, or desired angle in radians. There's no source for that. We'll have to come up with one. There's the gain of the gyro, converts that theta desired into a voltage desired here. There is a feedback value of that voltage. We take the difference, that gives us an error. The error goes into our controller, which is that simple proportional gain. That value Kp there, it is, MATLAB is reading from Simulink is reading it from the MATLAB workspace. I could alternately double click, open that block, and type in a numeric value. Here is getting from the voltage to the, essentially the rotational effect of the thrusters, multiplying by the thruster constant, the radius, the 2 times the thrusters, but I'm dividing by that rotational inertia. So I can add that to the forces divided by the inertia of the damping, add those two together, and I get my theta double dot, or the rotational acceleration. I integrate that, 1 over s. You may not be familiar with 1 over s being a notation for integration, but that goes to the Laplace transform concepts, and the Laplace transform of an integrator is 1 over s, where s is the Laplace variable. We will get to that later. So I integrate theta double dot, I get theta dot, I integrate it one more time, I get my angle, multiply that angle times the gain of the gyro, and I should have labeled this, and I'll have to put a 1 on it because it gets upset if you label 2 blocks the same. The output is the voltage that corresponds to that theta. And the other thing you'll notice is almost all of these signals have a name on them, so that you know what you're calculating. And again, you can say, does this name make sense given the inputs? It's very useful for debugging. It's very useful for when you hand this model over to somebody else. I've been in the position where I've gotten a model from another engineer from academia, and it's just all the blocks and no labels, and you look at it, and it's just as much work to walk through and try to reverse engineer the calculation, reverse engineer the units. It's almost as much work to just to do that as it is to start from scratch. So if you're handing people undocumented, unlabeled models, you're not doing them any favor. But we're missing a couple things. We want to have some source for theta desired. We want to be able to see what's going on. So I'm going to open the Simulink block model browser, or library browser. That's this little icon with 4 squares here. I need a source, something to create my desired target theta. I'm going to pick the step, just drag that over here on top of the model. And I'm going to want to see what the model did, so I'm going to go to sinks. I'm going to pick up the scope, drag it over, and I want to compare the target angle with the desired angle and overlay those. So I'm going to go to signal routing, and we'll go in, as you get practice, you'll learn more of this. This is just a quick example to give you a flavor. Grab the mux, drag this onto here. I can take this step And if I move it over here and line it up about with the beginning of that signal, it automatically connects it. Double click, I'm going to step at 10 seconds. Initial value is 0, final value of 2 times pi. Okay. I'm going to run it for 70 seconds. The default value is 10, but I just typed in 70 up there. If I just ran it for 10 seconds, nothing would happen because we don't put our step in until 10 seconds. The signals I want to display are the theta, so I'm going to right-click here in the middle of this line, drag it over until it touches, and let go. Another way I can connect things is I can go backwards and bring it down until it changes there, and that's connected. You can see a little dot there to indicate there's a connection. If it just crossed with no dot, there's no connection, and I can move these things around, and we can spend our entire career cleaning these things up. And I have a fairly complete model. I'll click on run, and I'll double click on the scope. Let's make it bigger so we can see this. Part of the graph is hidden, but if I click on auto scale, now I see the entire graph. At 10 seconds, the yellow line makes a jump from 0 to 2 pi. That's my input. The purple line, not a very good color choice personally, but what can I say? That's the default, is our measured angle of the satellite. So it takes about 20, 30 seconds to really settle in there. Okay, that's a long time. So what can we do? Well, we can play with my gyro gain. I could double click here, not gyro gain, excuse me. Play with my controller gain. I could put a number in there. I could go back to my script file. I could change it here and rerun the entire script file, and then it's saved. But I may not wish to mess with the script file. I may want to save that for posterity. So I will go straight to the MATLAB command window and type the KP equals 1. Leave the semicolon off. It echoes that back for me. Now I've changed the value of KP in my MATLAB workspace. When I go to my Simulink model, the value used in the simulation is going to change. Run it, double click on the scope, auto scale again. And you can see we've speeded it up, but we've also introduced some overshoot, which may or may not be what is desired in this case. So that way we've created a model, we can play with the controller, we can change the controller type, we can do all these things and in Simulink and improve our understanding and have some confidence that when we launch something like this, that we'll have an appropriate gain in it, because once it's launched, it's, you know, very difficult and expensive to come back and fix it. Run the simulations, we play with it, and I hope you found this useful, and we'll catch you on the flip side.